Tanto Audio, a division of recorded books, presents The Party, The Secret World of China's Communist Rulers by Richard McGregor. Narrated by Matthew Waterson. Prologue. It was the summer of 2008, 1 year into the banking crisis in the West. A small group of foreigners, called to China to give financial advice, were ushered into the walled leadership compound astride the Forbidden City in central Beijing. Once in the meeting room, the visitors perched on the edges of the overstuffed armchairs, draped with antimacassars and laid out in a U-shape to create the effect of a space split perfectly down the middle, dividing the visitors from the Chinese. The decorative flowers, the steaming mugs of tea, the warm words of welcome for friends from afar, all the ingredients of the time-honored template for respectful encounters with foreigners were on display. For the attentive listener, the only part of the meeting that didn't follow the script was their host sitting opposite, Wang Qishan, the vice premier in charge of China's financial sector. Tall, with flat, wide cheekbones and a sharp, imposing manner, the new Politburo member had never been one of those officials whose Delphic utterances left interlocutors trying to decipher their meaning afterwards. The Chinese had once used such encounters to solicit foreign views, like bowerbirds eager to stock up on fresh policy ideas. But Wang quickly made it clear that China had little to learn from the visitors about its financial system. Mr. Wang said, "This is what you do, and this is what we do," which is what the Chinese always say, one of the participants recalled. But his message was different. It was, "You have your way, we have our way, and our way is right." When China staged its first Davos-style event in 2001, global financiers started traveling there as keenly as they did to the annual conference in the Swiss Alps it was styled after. The limousines whisking the financial elite from the airport in tropical Hainan in April 2009 to the seaside conference center sped through a landscape unlike the usual venues for power meetings in China. The wide, imperious avenues and stiffly guarded marble buildings of Beijing, with their vast entrance portals and stylized meeting rooms, were a world away. Unlike the bone-dry northern capital, dusted brown by sands blown in from the nearby desert, the Boao Forum, named after the balmy bay where it is held, was designed to match the message of warm friendship a rising China was determined to convey. In the early years of the meeting, the courtship had been mutual. Beijing wanted Western skills to overhaul their bankrupt state banks. The foreign bankers eyed access to the Chinese market in return. The down payment was delivered in a frenzy of deals in late 2005 and early 2006, when foreign financial institutions invested tens of billions of dollars in Chinese state lenders. The money came with a promise from the foreigners to the laggard locals to teach them the secrets of risk management and financial innovation. The Western banks approached the exercise almost as adult education, which is why what happened subsequently was so shocking. Barely 2 years after the big Chinese banking deals, the humbled Visigoths of global finance were back. This time, battered by the unfolding credit crisis, they returned, humiliated, cap in hand, seeking Chinese cash to shore up their balance sheets or selling their newly acquired shares to take money home. Rather than displaying their wares in Boao and Beijing, the bankers and their advisors slunk in and out of town with barely a peep. One by one, at the 2009 Boao Forum, senior Chinese officials tossed aside the soothing messages of past conferences to drive this reversal of fortune home. The first, a financial regulator, lambasted a recent meeting of global leaders as lip service. Another tore into the role of international ratings agencies in the financial crisis. A retired Politburo member ominously suggested the US needed to make sure it protected the interests of Asian countries if it wanted China to keep buying its debt. When it was his turn at the mic at the session in the resort's Oriental Room, the man anointed as the global face of China Inc. dropped his polite facade as well. Lu Jiwei, as the first head of the China Investment Corporation, the country's sovereign wealth fund, had been careful to project a conciliatory image since the body's establishment in 2007. The first difficult years in the job had slowly soured Lu's good cheer, The fund's bold initial investments offshore had lost money, attracting vitriolic criticism at home. Abroad, Lou became bitter at the opposition he faced to investing in the US and Germany. Lou recounted to the Boal dignitaries how a delegation from the European Union had demanded after the fund's establishment that he cap any stakes he bought in their companies and not ask for voting rights in return for shares purchased. Lou reckoned he was lucky in retrospect to meet such patronizing intransigence, because he would have lost a ton of money if he had been allowed into the market. So I want to thank these financial protectionists, because as a result, we didn't invest a single cent in Europe. Now, he noted sardonically, to a mixture of stifled guffaws and startled gasps in the audience, Europeans had sheepishly returned to tell him his money was welcome, with no strings attached. People suddenly think we are lovable. The same mood of brittle triumphalism on display at Boao had begun to course through government pronouncements, official debates, the state media, and bilateral meetings at home and abroad from early 2009. Behind the scenes, in ways not easily visible from the outside, the official propaganda machine had clicked into overdrive as well. The People's Daily, the mouthpiece of the Chinese Communist Party, usually reserved its front page for the daily diaries of top leaders, their foreign guests, and the latest political campaigns. The paper, which acts as a kind of internal bulletin board for officials, relegated finance stories to the back pages, if they were reported at all. The announcement in March 2009 of healthy profits by the big Chinese banks, once derided in the West as financial zombies, made for an irresistible exception. The banner headline on the paper's front page screamed, "China's banking system hands in a fabulous exam paper, stands out after being tested by the international financial storm." For a decade, Beijing had resisted pressure from Washington, led laterally by the former Goldman Sachs boss, Hank Paulson, as Treasury Secretary, for wholesale financial liberalization. In the 7 years to 2008, the Chinese economy had more than tripled in size. But alongside China's rise, the patience with which Beijing listened to advice from foreigners had been dwindling. It wasn't until the Western financial crisis that the confidence of the likes of Wang Qishan spread through the system and burst to the surface like never before. Many Chinese leaders were beginning to voice out loud the sentiments expressed privately by Wang. What on earth have we to learn from the West? China's post-Maoist governing model, launched by Deng Xiaoping in the late 70s, has endured many attempts to explain it. Is it a benevolent Singapore-style autocracy? A capitalist development state, as many described Japan? Neo-Confucianism mixed with market economics? A slow-motion version of post-Soviet Russia in which the elite grabbed productive public assets for private gain? Robber baron socialism? Or is it something different altogether, an entirely new model, a Beijing consensus, according to the fashionable phrase, built around practical problem-solving policies and technological innovation? Few described the model as communist anymore, often not even the ruling Chinese Communist Party itself. How communism came to be airbrushed out of the rise of the world's greatest communist state is no mystery on one level. The multiple head-spinning contradictions about modern China can throw anyone off the scent. What was once a revolutionary party is now firmly the establishment. The communists rode to power on popular revulsion against corruption, but have become riddled by the same cancer themselves. Top leaders adhere to Marxism in their public statements, even as they depend on a ruthless private sector to create jobs. The party preaches equality while presiding over incomes as unequal as anywhere in Asia. The communists also once despised the pre-revolutionary comprador class of Chinese businessmen, but rushed without shame into an alliance with Hong Kong tycoons when taking back the British colony in 1997. The gap between the fiction of the party's rhetoric, China is a socialist country, and the reality of everyday life grows larger every year. But the party must defend the fiction nonetheless, because it represents the political status quo. Their ideology is an ideology of power and therefore a defense of power, said Richard Baum, a China scholar. The party's defense of power is also, by extension, a defense of the existing system. In the words of Dai Bingguo, China's most senior foreign policy official, China's number one core interest is to maintain its fundamental system and state security. State sovereignty, territorial integrity, and economic development, the priorities of any state, are all subordinate to the need to keep the party in power. The party has made strenuous efforts to keep the sinews of its enduring power off the front stage of public life in China and out of sight of the rest of the world. For many in the West, it has been convenient to keep the party backstage too, and pretend that China has an evolving governmental system with strengths and weaknesses, quirks and foibles like any other. China's flourishing commercial life and embrace of globalization is enough for many to dismiss the idea that communism still has traction, as if a Starbucks on every corner is a marker of political progress. Peek under the hood of the Chinese model, however, and China looks much more communist than it does on the open road. Vladimir Lenin, who designed the prototype used to run communist countries around the world, would recognize the model immediately. The Chinese Communist Party's enduring grip on power is based on a simple formula straight out of the Leninist playbook. For all the reforms of the past three decades, the party has made sure it keeps a lockhold on the state and three pillars of its survival strategy: control of personnel, propaganda, and the People's Liberation Army. Since installing itself as the sole legitimate governing authority of a unified China in 1949, the party and its leaders have placed its members in key positions in every arm and at each level of the state. All the Chinese media come under the control of the propaganda department, even if its denizens have had to gallop to keep up in the internet age. And if anyone decides to challenge the system, the party has kept ample power in reserve, making sure it maintains a tight grip on the military and the security services, the ultimate guarantors of its rule. The police forces at every level of government, from large cities to small villages, have within them a domestic security department, the role of which is to protect the party's rule and weed out dissenting political voices before they can gain a broad audience. China long ago dispensed with old-style communist central planning for a sleeker, hybrid market economy, the party's greatest innovation. But measure China against a definitional checklist authored by Robert Service, the veteran historian of Soviet Russia, and Beijing retains a surprising number of the qualities that characterized communist regimes of the 20th century. Like communism in its heyday elsewhere, the party in China has eradicated or emasculated political rivals, eliminated the autonomy of the courts and press, restricted religion and civil society, denigrated rival versions of nationhood, centralized political power, established extensive networks of security police, and dispatched dissidents to labor camps. Over much of its life, although less so now, party leaders in China have mimicked old-style communists by claiming infallibility in doctrine while proclaiming themselves to be faultless scientists of human affairs. The party in China has teetered on the verge of self-destruction numerous times, in the wake of Mao Zedong's brutal campaigns over three decades from the 50s, and then again in 1989 after the army's suppression of demonstrations in Beijing and elsewhere. The party itself suffered an existential crisis after the collapse of the Soviet Union and its satellite states in the 3 years to 1992, an event that resonates to this day in the corridors of power in Beijing. After each catastrophe, the party has picked itself off the ground, reconstituted its armor, and reinforced its flanks. Somehow it has outlasted, outsmarted, outperformed, or simply outlawed its critics, flummoxing the pundits who have predicted its demise at numerous junctures. As a political machine alone, the party is a phenomenon of awesome and unique dimensions. By the end of 2009, its membership stood at 78 million, equal to about 1 in 12 adult Chinese. The party's marginalization of all political opponents makes it somewhat like the Iraqi army after the Second Gulf War. Even if it were disbanded or fell apart, it would have to be put back together again, because its members alone have the skills, experience, and networks to run the country. As a prominent Shanghai professor told me, the party's attitude is, "I can do it and you can't, and because you can't, I will." The party's logic is circular. There can be no alternative because none is allowed to exist. Few events symbolize the advance of China and the retreat of the West during the financial crisis more than the touchdown in Beijing of Hillary Clinton, the new U.S. Secretary of State, in February 2009. Previous U.S. administrations under Bill Clinton and George W. Bush had arrived in office with an aggressive, competitive posture towards China. Before she landed, Ms. Clinton publicly downplayed the importance of human rights. At a press conference ahead of leaving, she beamingly implored the Chinese government to keep buying U.S. debt, like a traveling saleswoman hawking a bill of goods. Deng Xiaoping's crafty stratagem, laid down two decades before, about how China should advance stealthily into the world, hide your brightness, bide your time, had been honored in the breach long before Ms. Clinton's arrival. China's high-profile tours through Africa, South America, and Australia in search of resources, the billion-dollar listings of its state companies on overseas stock markets, its rising profile in the United Nations, and its sheer economic firepower had made China the new focus of global business and finance since the turn of the century. China's star was shining more brightly than ever before, even as its diplomats protested they were battling to be heard on behalf of a relatively poor, developing economy. The implosion of the Western financial system, along with an evaporation of confidence in the US, Europe, and Japan, overnight pushed China's global standing several notches higher. In the space of a few months in early 2009, unconstrained by any serious public debate at home, the Chinese state committed $50 billion in extra funding for the International Monetary Fund and $38 billion with Hong Kong for an Asian Monetary Fund, extended a $25 billion loan to cash-strapped Russian oil companies, set aside $30 billion for Australian resource companies, offered tens of billions more to various countries or companies in South America, Central, and Southeast Asia to lock up commodities and lay down its marker for future purchases. In September that year, with Western governments and companies still on the back foot, China readied lines of credit up to $60 to $70 billion for resource and infrastructure deals in Africa, in Nigeria, Ghana, and Kenya. In Guinea, just days after the army had shot citizens and raped women on the streets of the capital, the military-backed government, a pariah on the continent and around the world, announced it was in talks with China on a billion-dollar resources and infrastructure deal. Beijing's ambition and clout was being lit up by flashing lights in ways that would have been unthinkable a few years previously. The Chinese central bank called for an alternative to the US dollar as a global reserve currency in early 2009 and reiterated its policy as the year went on. France obediently recommitted to Chinese sovereignty over Tibet to placate Beijing's anger over the issue, after Beijing had cancelled an EU summit in protest at Paris's welcome for the Dalai Lama. Barack Obama spurned meeting the Tibetan spiritual leader in late 2009 to sweeten the atmosphere for his first visit to Beijing in November that year, although he did agree to meet him in early 2010. On its Navy's 60th anniversary, China invited the world to view its new fleet of nuclear-powered submarines off the port of Qingdao. In the days before he arrived in Washington on a fence-mending state visit in January 2011, President Hu Jintao pointedly reminded his hosts that the U.S.-led international monetary system was a product of the past. The giant Chinese market, dismissed as an enduring Western dream a few years previously, had become more important than ever. Just ahead of the Shanghai Auto Show in April 2009, monthly passenger car sales in China were the highest of any market in the world, surpassing the U.S. A month later, Wang Qishan and a team of Chinese ministers met Catherine Ashton, the then EU Trade Commissioner, and about 15 of Europe's most senior business executives in Brussels to hear their complaints about Chinese market access. "Sure," Wang conceded after listening to their problems over a working lunch, "there are irregularities in the market." "I know you have complaints," he replied as confidently as ever, "but the charm of the Chinese market is irresistible." In other words, according to executives in this meeting, left astonished by the Vice Premier, "whatever your complaints, the market is so big, you are going to come anyway." Even worse, many of the executives realized that Wang was right. China's aggressive new confidence was on display on a wide screen by the end of 2009. At the Copenhagen Climate Change Conference. In the final fractious day of negotiations, the Chinese snubbed a heads of state session, sending along a relatively junior official to talk with President Obama and other world leaders. At another session on the same day, this one attended by Wen Jiabao, China's premier, a member of the Chinese delegation loudly lectured Obama, waving his finger at the US president. Needless to say, if a relatively junior Western government official had been dispatched to meet a Chinese leader, and even worse, delivered him a lecture, the affront would have been serious enough to have provoked violent anti-foreign street demonstrations at home in Beijing. China was nonplussed by criticism afterwards. What the developed countries need to learn from this whole process is to make up their minds whether they want to pursue confrontation or cooperation with China, said a senior official. The growth and transformation of Asian countries in the wake of decolonization after World War II, countries such as Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, and South Korea, were important for the citizens of those countries and uplifting for the region. Japan's rise as an economic giant shook up and challenged the West. The economic transformation of China, by contrast, a country with one-fifth of the world's population, is a global event without parallel. The rise of China is a genuine megatrend, a phenomenon with the ability to remake the world economy sector by sector. That it is presided over by a communist party makes it even more jarring for a Western world, which, only a few years previously, was feasting on notions of the end of history and the triumph of liberal democracy. More than that, the party's momentous decision to change course in the late 70s has transformed the lives of literally hundreds of millions of its own people. According to the World Bank, the number of poor fell in China by 500 million people in the two decades plus from 1981 to 2004. To put this in perspective, the bank says, the absolute number of poor, using the same standard, in the developing world as a whole declined from 1.5 to 1.1 billion over the same period. In other words, but for China, there would have been no decline in the numbers of poor in the developing world over the last two decades of the 20th century. In just a single generation, the party elite has been transformed from a mirthless band of Mao-suited ideological thugs to a wealthy, besuited, and business-friendly ruling class. Along with them, they have transformed their country and are helping remake the world. Today's party is all about joining the highways of globalization, which in turn translates into greater economic efficiencies, higher rates of return, and greater political security. How did the Chinese communists do it, at a time when their fraternal parties were imploding around them? An old adage in journalism that the best story is often the one staring you in the face holds true in China. The problem in writing about the party, though, is that, much as the party might be staring you in the face, you can't easily glare back. The party and its functions are generally masked or dressed up in other guises. When it interacts with the outside world, the party is careful to keep a low profile. Sometimes you can't see the party at all, which makes the job of reporting how China is governed maddeningly difficult. This secrecy helps explain why news reports about China routinely refer to the ruling Communist Party, while rarely elaborating on how it actually rules. This book is an attempt to fill that void, by explaining the party's functions and structures and how political power is exercised through them. The book has no pretense to being comprehensive or definitive. It is simply the story of a curious journalist opening, or trying to open, the system's many locked doors and looking inside. In doing so, the book aims to place the Communist Party back firmly where it belongs, at the heart of the modern Chinese story. 1. The Red Machine. The Party and the State. The party is like God. He is everywhere. You just can't see him. A university professor in Beijing. Nine men strode onto the stage in the Great Hall of the People, the imposing Soviet-style structure on the west side of Tiananmen Square, in the heart of Beijing, at the close of the 2007 Congress of the Chinese Communist Party. Once they were assembled, an untrained eye might have had difficulty telling them apart. The nine all wore dark suits, and all but one sported a red tie. They all displayed slick, jet-black pompadours, a product of the uniform addiction to regular hair dyeing of senior Chinese politicians, a habit only broken by retirement or imprisonment. If anyone had had the chance to check their biographies, they would have noticed other striking similarities. All but one had trained as engineers, and all but two were in their mid-60s. In any jobs they had occupied after graduation, the nine men had invariably doubled in party roles, making them full-time politicians for their entire working lives, even if that included undertaking or overseeing professional tasks for brief interludes. Their backgrounds varied slightly. Some had worked their way up from poverty. Others were princelings, the privileged offspring of former senior leaders. Their personal networks varied, but any fundamental political differences between them had been purged on their ascent through the ranks by the party's remorseless strictures. In the time-honored fashion of communist-era stage entrances, the nine had gently clapped themselves onto the podium as they walked into position for the upcoming ceremony. For the mass of media and government officials assembled to witness the ritual, carried out with a dark, theatrical pomp, the most important thing was not how they walked onto the stage, nor the striking similarity of their appearance and career history. The key was in the order in which they appeared, as it cemented the hierarchy of the top leadership for the next 5 years, and laid out a line of succession for the entire decade to come until 2022. Against the backdrop of a 20-meter-wide painting of an autumnal scene on the Great Wall, the nine stopped and stood to attention. Standing stiffly, they were ready to be introduced by the man at the head of the line, Hu Jintao, the General Secretary of the Communist Party, as the elected leaders of their country. Ahead of the Congress, the authorities had executed the well-honed security routines reserved for major political events. The guard on diplomatic compounds was doubled, police were stationed at highway intersections, and scores of scowling, plain-clothed security men materialized in the streets around the Great Hall of the People. Local scholars received circulars reminding them to keep their opinions to themselves. In September, a month before the Congress, internet data centers were raided, with servers keeping literally thousands of websites shut down for weeks. On the fringes of the city, the authorities had set about demolishing the petitioners' village area where many out-of-towners with grievances congregated. For centuries, the central government has maintained a national petitions office in the capital to which citizens take complaints about official misconduct. Ahead of the Congress, though, Beijing threatened to mark down the careers of local leaders if residents from their cities managed to get to the capital to make use of it. In case anyone got past the security cordon, the provinces maintain a last line of defense to protect the Politburo from the public, a string of black jails or unregistered prisons where local complainants can be held before being sent home. Detaining protesters, according to this formula, is akin to winning political points in the West for keeping the crime rate down. State security, local activists, government officials, and the foreign and Chinese media alike have all learnt over time to internalize the seasonal rhythms of repression that turn with the political calendar. Television interviews with important dissidents are best done months ahead of time. By the time the day itself comes around, physical access and even phone contact to critics of the party is cut off. Wang Yanhai, an outspoken AIDS campaigner, was one of many activists whisked off the streets and taken into temporary custody. Wan was picked up and detained without charge for 12 hours, ahead of the anniversary of the 4th of June 1989 military crackdown, and again for a few days in August. "My freedom was restricted," he said, echoing the deadpan phrase that state security uses when they haul people off the streets. Wan had riled the health ministry by attempting to sue the government over a contaminated blood scandal. He kept himself on the radar of state security through his unabashed friendships with dissidents. On each occasion, Wan was kept in a hotel room while the authorities counseled him about his views on the party. "They still care very much about controlling our thoughts," he said later. In the years and months leading up to the choice of the leadership, there had been no public primaries, pre-selections, or runoffs, and none of the noisy blood and thunder clashes that are familiar events in the lead-up to Western electoral contests. Following this drama for much of the time had been like standing outside a large fortified castle surrounded by moats and guards, watching as lights were turned on and off and visitors whisked in and out. Raised voices could occasionally be heard from behind the thick walls. Once in a while, there was hard evidence of conflict, as the casualties of corruption scandals, factional clashes, or plain mismanagement were thrown out onto the street, to be carted off into retirement or prison. In the lead-up to the 2007 Congress, the party boss of Shanghai, China's commercial capital, had been toppled, the highest-level corruption scandal in a decade, and one that had taken years of tense negotiations among top leaders before it could be settled. The party has unveiled its new leadership and, by definition, the leadership of the government and the country, in the same way for decades. As in any high-stakes political showdown, the leadership candidates have been locked in complex, private negotiations, and in some cases bitter battles, long beforehand, directly or through proxies and policy debates, over the economy, political reform, and corruption. The Hong Kong and foreign press tracked the infighting as best they could, but the local media, naturally far better informed, were ordered to keep silent. The shroud pulled over the event turned the announcement into something rare in modern China, a live and public moment of genuine political drama and suspense. For ordinary Chinese, the precise identity and ranking of their new leadership was, for all intents and purposes, a secret until the moment they walked onto the stage into a blaze of television and flashing camera lights. After leading the procession on stage, Hu spoke briefly, introducing each of the nine men by name. A foreign ministry official had described the event beforehand as a meeting with a Politburo. "So, can we ask questions?" queried a reporter. "No," the official replied. "It's a kind of one-way press conference." The next day, the local media reported it strictly in accordance with the party's dictates, along with the approved, sanitized biographies of the new Politburo members distributed by the official news agency. For anyone who lined up the Chinese newspapers side by side the next morning, or took snapshots of the home pages of websites, the effect was almost hallucinatory. The wording of the headlines and articles and the choice, size, and placement of photos were all exactly the same. Chinese leaders periodically express bafflement when critics suggest their ascension is somehow not democratic. A few months later, in May 2008, when visiting a school for Chinese children in Yokohama, Japan, Hu Jintao was asked by a guileless 8-year-old why he wanted to be president, a title that comes to him by rights these days, after being chosen as the head of the party. After the nervous laughter in the classroom died down, Hu replied that he had not wanted the job. "It was the people in the whole country who voted me in and wanted me to be the president. I should not let the people throughout the whole country down," he replied. Similarly, Jiang Zemin, whose predecessor both as party secretary and president, told a U.S. current affairs show in 2000 that he was elected too, although he did concede the two countries' electoral systems were different. During the 2007 Congress, delegates were allowed, or in some cases ordered, to talk to the media in an effort to fashion a more transparent, friendly image for the party in the outside world. It is not as though the party does not have an interesting story to sell, and in recent years a broader class of member to present to the world. Many of the private businessmen and women who joined the party or were able to acknowledge their existing membership after Jiang Zemin pushed through approval for their presence in 2002, are ebullient figures with stirring rags-to-riches life stories. But even when the party tries to force its best foot forward, it is evasive and suspicious. When I met Chen Ailian, one of China's newly minted millionaires and a party member and delegate, she initially delighted in telling me about her business. Chen had the kind of mad and wonderful entrepreneurial story you hear often across China. She said she had entered the automotive business in the early 1990s because she loved cars. Many millions of dollars in sales later, her private company had become the largest aluminium alloy wheel manufacturer in Asia and had opened offices in the US. Chen owned a Rolls Royce for special occasions, a Mercedes for everyday use, and an Isuzu sports utility vehicle for road trips. But once our conversation turned to the party, she became more automaton than entrepreneur. To even the gentlest of questions, she adopted a reverential, whispering in church tone. Her answers became somber, restrained, and drained of life, consisting of little other than official slogans. Atop of the system sits Hu. As General Secretary of the Communist Party, a position which ranks above his two other titles as president and head of the military, he retains enormous power to set the parameters for government policy. An enigmatic figure even to political insiders, Hu had attempted to fashion an imperial-era image for himself in his first 5-year term, starting in 2002, as a kind of benevolent emperor whose interventions in policy and politics were as wise and weighty as they were rare. At one time identified with the reform camp, The clarity that marked his personal politics clouded over as he rose through the ranks as the heir apparent in the early 90s. The tools to enforce the refurbishment of his image were close at hand for a man of his office. His elderly aunt, who had raised him from the age of 5, and who had been, for a handful of foreign interviewers, a rare source of unfiltered information, had been stopped by local officials from talking to reporters soon after he was first named party secretary. The officials had even visited her house to remove pictures of him as a child and youth, lest they be handed out to reporters and the like, and become part of an independent narrative of his life, not dictated by the party itself. The pictures of a young Hu, posted on the internet in 2009, 7 years after his appointment, were harmlessly charming, of a fresh-faced high school student on class outings, but local officials at the time of his ascension did not want to take responsibility for their publication. Hu had been careful not to flesh out any broader picture of himself, never granting an interview to either the local or foreign press in his first term. In the lead-up to the Beijing Olympics in August 2008, Hu did give a short press conference to 25 foreign journalists, only after all their questions had been carefully screened. His pronouncements, that appear regularly in the People's Daily, the party's mouthpiece, provided few firm clues about his personal views. One Chinese commentator likened his policy pronouncements to a duck walking, with one foot pointed to the right and the other to the left, maintaining an ungainly balance which looked stable only from a distance. Hu's severe image management might have seemed like a conservative throwback to an earlier age of more authoritarian communism. In fact, compared to his predecessors, Hu was a bland figure, determinedly drained of flesh and blood. Deng Xiaoping, by contrast, had a revolutionary prestige, overlaid by the battle scars of years of struggle against Mao Zedong's insane political campaigns. He proudly displayed his earthy Sichuanese roots, notoriously expectorating loudly into his spittoon while delivering to Margaret Thatcher an intimidating lecture about Hong Kong at a meeting in the early 80s in Beijing. Jiang Zemin, whose immediate predecessor, delighted in singing in public and reciting extracts from the Gettysburg Address and other Western canons in English. Mao, for all the horrors he inflicted on the Chinese people, was a charismatic figure renowned for his pithy aphorisms, which endure in China's literary, political, and business landscape. Hu displayed neither Deng's down-to-earth vigor, Jiang's clownish chumminess, nor Mao's terrifying homespun authority. He has no distinctive accent signaling his regional roots, nor any memorable quotes which have passed into everyday lore. A British diplomat, arranging Hu's presence at a session of the G8 meeting in Gleneagle, Scotland, in 2005, designed to be an informal and free-flowing meeting between leaders, was given short shrift about the proposed format by his Chinese interlocutor. President Hu does not do free-flowing, he was told. The apotheosis of the professional party bureaucrat, who was a cautious, careful consensus builder, a Hao Hai Si, or good boy, according to his more cutting local critics. But far from being old-fashioned, Hu's low-key, self-effacing qualities made him very much a man for the times. China's modern complexities mean the party, whose peers and even the people themselves, can no longer stomach strongman rule of the likes of Mao and Deng. In Mao's and Deng's days, the leaders towered over the party. For all his power, Hu lived in the party's shadow, rather than the other way round. The way the party has grown at the expense of its leaders dictated Hu's low profile long before his promotion to party secretary. After he emerged as the heir apparent on his elevation to the Politburo Standing Committee in 1992, Hu's lack of a Politburo power base afforded him no room for error in the competition for the party secretary's job. By the time he took office, 10 years later, he had few of his loyalists in place as a result and no detailed political program pre-positioned, which the bureaucracy could internalize and act on. Hu did not begin to gain genuine ascendancy over the vast party apparatus, both in Beijing and in the rest of the country, until well into the second of his 2 5-year terms. Most US presidents become lame ducks in the last years of their final term. So topsy-turvy is the Chinese political system that Hu, like Jiang Zemin before him, only really consolidated power by the time he was approaching the end of his period in office. With the public shut out of formal politics, few ordinary citizens could even recognize most of the 9 men in the Politburo's inner circle who lined up on stage at the Congress's closure. Who, of course, was a familiar face, if not a familiar personality. Wu Bangguo, at number two and head of the legislature, was a colorless Shanghai functionary who had risen without a trace to the near top of the leadership. Wen Jiabao, the premier, ranked number three, had skillfully cultivated an image as a man of the people, in contrast to the hard-earned notoriety of his wife and son for their business dealings. Jia Qinglin, who strode out in fourth position, was a big man, tall and flush, and bursting out of his suit like someone who had enjoyed too many banquets. Unlike most of his colleagues, Jia was well known, only because of his alleged corruption. Jia presided over Fujian province during one of China's worst graft scandals, the Yuanhua case, a $6 billion customs fraud. Numerous officials have already been executed and jailed for their crimes, but Jia and his wife, also the target of allegations, have never been called to account, either because there is not enough evidence against them or, more likely, because they've been protected by political allies. As he stood on stage and stared out at the assembled media, many of whom had expected him to be toppled and disgraced in the lead-up to the Congress, Jia's ruddy face had the defiant sneer of a triumphant, well-nourished political survivor. Other members of the standing committee, including two in their 50s, who are Hu's designated successors, were only vaguely recognizable in the provinces they once governed. By the time he joined the standing committee, Xi Jinping, ranked number six and anointed as the heir apparent, was less well known than his wife, a famous singer with a military rank in the People's Liberation Army. Some of the men on stage had profiles in the sectors, such as the media and policing, that they had presided over. But for most Chinese, the Politburo was a distant body, bloated with power, but devoid of character and personality. Hu's speech was brief and couched in the arcane political slogans that dominate all official public political discussion about scientific development, the harmonious society, an advanced socialist culture, and so on. Heavy with import inside the party and intellectual circles as the branding buzzwords of Hu's administration, they are largely meaningless to the population at large. After concluding his remarks, Hu led his eight colleagues off stage. In the coming years, the Politburo's inner circle would rarely ever appear in public as a group again. The whole ceremony had lasted about 10 minutes. On the desks of the heads of China's 50-odd biggest state companies, amid the clutter of computers, family photos, and other fixtures of the modern CEO's office life, sits a red phone. The executives and their staff who jump to attention when it rings know it as the red machine, perhaps because to call it a mere phone does not do it justice. When the red machine rings, a senior executive of a state bank told me, you had better make sure you answer it. The red machine is like no ordinary phone. Each one has just a four-digit number. It connects only to similar phones with four-digit numbers within the same encrypted system. They are much coveted nonetheless. For the chairmen and women of the top state companies who have every modern communications device at their fingertips, the red machine is a sign they have arrived, not just at the top of the company, but in the senior ranks of the party and the government. The phones are the ultimate status symbol, as they are only given out to people in jobs with the rank of vice minister and above. They are very convenient and also very dangerous, said an executive of a large state resources company. You want to be sure of your relationship with whichever person you call. Down the corridor from the executive offices is an additional tool for ranking officials, an internal communications room which receives secure faxes from Zhongnanhai, the leadership compound, and other sections of the party and government system. Red machines are dotted throughout Beijing in offices of officials of the requisite rank, on the desks of ministers and vice ministers, the chief editors of party newspapers, the chairmen and women of the elite state enterprises, and the leaders of innumerable party-controlled bodies. The phones and faxes are encrypted not just to secure party and government communications from foreign intelligence agencies. They also provide protection against snooping by anyone in China outside the party's governing system. Possession of the red machine means you've qualified for membership of the tight-knit club that runs the country, a small group of mainly men with responsibility for about one-fifth of humanity. The modern world is replete with examples of elite networks that wield behind-the-scenes power beyond their mere numerical strength. The United Kingdom had the Old Boy Network, originally coined to describe connections between former students of upper-class, non-government schools. France has Les Anarchs, the alumni of the exclusive École Nationale d'Administration in Paris, who cluster in the upper levels of commerce and politics. And Japan has the Todai elite, graduates of the law school of Tokyo University, an entry point into the long-time ruling Liberal Democratic Party, the finance ministry, and business. In India, the exclusive Gymkhana Club symbolizes the English-educated elite. The US has the Ivy League, the Beltway, K Street, and the military-industrial complex, and a host of other labels to signify the opaque influence of well-connected insiders. None can hold a candle to the Chinese Communist Party, which takes ruling class networking to an entirely new level. The Red Machine gives the party apparatus a hotline into multiple arms of the state, including the government-owned companies that China promotes around the world these days as independent commercial entities. Critics of the Republican administration of George W. Bush decried what they said were the cozy links between Dick Cheney, the vice president, and the energy industry, to take one example. Imagine the case the critics could have mounted if Cheney and the CEO of ExxonMobil and America's other big energy companies had secure phones on their desks, establishing a permanent speed dial connection with each other. In turn, to extend the analogy, what would they have made of the ExxonMobil CEO receiving a steady stream of party and government documents available to the executives of Chinese state companies by virtue of their office and rank? The Red Machine and the trappings that go with it perform precisely these functions. One vice minister told me that more than half of the calls he received on his Red Machine were requests for favors from senior party officials, along the lines of, "Can you give my son, daughter, niece, nephew, cousin, or good friend, and so on, a job?" Over the years, he had developed a strategy to handle personal requests, welcoming them effusively while adding that the potential applicant first had to sit the grueling test required for entry into the civil service, which few were willing to do. The Red Machine has other uses. In the days before mobile phones, well-connected investment bankers who could not get through to top officials would try to borrow the Red Machine in offices they were visiting when the boss was out to put through a call directly to a potential top client. Quaint as it may seem in the age of sophisticated mobile telephony, the Red Machine remains a powerful symbol of the party's system's unparalleled reach, strict hierarchies, meticulous organization, and obsessive secrecy. The phone's color, revolutionary red, resonates as well. During political crises, the party frets about China changing color, code for the Red Communists losing power. Top-ranked party members enjoy a social standing beyond the respect that officials get anyway in a country with deep bureaucratic traditions. Much as if they have been granted diplomatic status in their own country, they live in secure compounds, but also have their overseas travel restricted and mingle with people beyond official circles and their immediate family, according to strict security protocols. They answer to the party first, not to the law of the land, if they are accused of criminal wrongdoing. But the benefits come at a cost. Beyond the personal stress and the impact on families that public officials around the world complain of, party membership is a commitment, not a simple enrollment. The Chinese who are promoted into senior positions must take whatever assignment they are handed and cannot easily leave the party without grave consequences. Above a certain level, senior officials are much like Michael Corleone in The Godfather, who lamented after trying to leave the family's mafia business that every time he tried to get out, they pulled me back in. It is no coincidence that the Vatican is one of the few states with which China has been unable to establish diplomatic ties since the founding of the People's Republic in 1949. The city-state, which is the administrative center of the Catholic Church and the home of the Pope, is the only other organization of comparable dimensions to the Chinese Communist Party, albeit on a global scale, and with a similar addiction to ritual and secrecy. The party guards the command of its catechism as zealously and self-righteously as the Vatican defends its authority over the faith. After years of on and off talks, the Vatican has not been able to reconcile its worldwide prerogative to appoint bishops with the party's insistence that it alone has the right to approve their choice for the Catholic Church at home in China. The on and off again talks between Rome and Beijing have been punctuated in private by a self-aware black humor. One of the unofficial Chinese intermediaries with Rome joked about the uncanny similarities between the party and the Catholic Church when he visited the Vatican in 2008. We have the propaganda department, and you have the evangelicals. We have the organization, personnel department, and you have the College of Cardinals, he told a Vatican official. What's the difference then? The official asked. The Chinese interlocutor replied, to hearty laughter all around, you are God, and we are the devil. Like the Vatican, the party has always made sure top-level decisions are kept in the family. Whose fantasy about being chosen by the whole country skated around the fact that the delegates to the 2007 Congress and earlier such meetings had been the only citizens allowed to vote. Even then, the 2,200-odd Congress attendees were deprived of any choice. In the lead-up to the Congress, Chinese political scholars had been teased with suggestions that the delegates would be presented with a slate of candidates, allowing them a genuine ballot to winnow down a larger list to the final nine. A more radical idea, copying the Vietnamese Communist Party's decision in 2006 at its Congress in Hanoi to allow two candidates for the position of General Secretary, had also been internally debated. Both options were quietly discarded for a traditional communist-style ballot. The names of the bodies through which the party exercises power, the Politburo, the Central Committee, the Presidium, and the like, all betray one of the most overlooked facts about the modern Chinese state: that it still runs on Soviet hardware. Vladimir Lenin, the leader of the Russian Revolution, designed a system according to which the ruling party shadows and stalks the state by penetrating it at all levels. Lenin presented himself as the savior of the working class, but the structure he devised was ferociously and brutally elitist. At the top of the system, Lenin prescribed as much centralization as possible, allowing self-appointed professional revolutionaries like himself to dictate downwards to a working class considered incapable of rising above their day-to-day struggles. In the bottom tier of the system, however, in the factories and grassroots party organizations, he prescribed as much decentralization as possible, so that information flowed upwards to a central committee about even the smallest local developments. For the center to actually direct the orchestra, Lenin wrote, it needs to know who plays violin and where, who plays a false note and why, when the music begins to grate on the ear, and how and where it is necessary to transfer someone to correct the dissonance. The Central Committee acts as a kind of enlarged board of directors for the party in China. With about 370 full and part-time members, the committee includes ministers and senior regulatory officials in Beijing, leaders of provincial governments and large cities, and a large block from the military. Some, but not all, of the heads of China's big state-owned enterprises are Central Committee members. An array of other interests, which make up the Leviathan of the Chinese state, ranging from representatives of minority communities, like Tibetans, to the head of Hu Jintao's Central Guards Unit, popularly known as the Bodyguard Bureau, the party's secret service makes up the remaining members. The Central Committee elects, or to be more precise, selects, the Politburo, which has about 25 members. The Politburo in turn selects the Standing Committee, the inner sanctum of the leadership, which in its present incarnation has 9 members. The 9 men filing out on stage in 2007 might have been the only candidates on the list presented to delegates as eligible for election for the top leadership positions. It was a moment of great import nonetheless, because within this small group, all of the levers of political power the party deploys to maintain its hold on the government, the country, and the 1.3 billion strong population had been divided up and allocated to each individual. The core responsibilities of the Politburo inner circle are not what you might expect to top the agenda of the country's elite leadership body, at least if you listened to the daily pronouncements of the central government in Beijing. The Politburo sets the general policy direction for the economy and diplomacy and has been preoccupied in recent years with China's towering challenges in meeting exploding energy demand, environmental degradation, and managing the mobile, 700 million strong rural population. Politburo members are briefed on these issues and have the final responsibility for deciding related policies, but they do not manage portfolios day to day in the way that ministers in a cabinet system do. The Politburo's overriding priorities lie elsewhere, in securing the party's grip on the state, the economy, the civil service, the military, police, education, social organizations, and the media, and controlling the very notion of China itself and the official narrative of its revival from an enfeebled power broken apart and humiliated by foreigners into a powerful state and resurgent civilization. More than a century after the model's invention, and 2 decades since its pioneer in Moscow and its Eastern European satellites fell apart, the core of the Chinese system, for all its indigenous modifications, still bears a remarkable resemblance to Lenin's original design. Even the Red Machine has Soviet antecedents. The Russians used a secure internal phone system known as the Vertushka, which loosely translates as the rotator, to connect the party elite. Mao initially adopted Soviet institutions, but he always regarded the party as bureaucratic and insufficiently revolutionary, complaining in the 50s that officials were tottering along like women in bound feet, always complaining that others were going too fast for them. Instead of the party supervising the people, Mao decided the people should supervise the party, a philosophy that triggered the 10 years of madness of the Cultural Revolution from 1966, when Red Guards were authorized to terrorize anyone they decided had strayed from the righteous path of revolution. Mao unleashed a revolution on a revolution that wasn't revolutionary enough, as a documentary described the period. After Mao's downfall and death, the party went back to basics. Deng Xiaoping threw out Mao's destructive notions and returned the party organization to its Leninist roots, as an empowered elite providing enlightened leadership to the masses. The notion of a party controlling the government, especially when the same party effectively is the government, remains conceptually difficult for many to grasp. When I lived in Shanghai for 4 years from 2000, I would advise visitors confused about this concept to keep an eye out for the official cars whisking top municipal leaders in and out of the city leadership compound in Kanping Road, a stern, grey marble low-rise carved out of the elegant, tree-lined backstreets of the old French concession. The cars provided an easy first lesson about Chinese politics, Leninism 101 if you like, as their number plates clearly spelt out the ruling hierarchies in the city. The Shanghai Party Secretary's plate is numbered 00001. The Mayor and Deputy Party Secretary's plate is 00002, one rung below, and that of the Executive Vice Mayor and the next most senior member of the city's party committee is 00003, and so on. The number plates are a banal illustration of the most important guiding principle of Chinese politics, of the party's ascendancy over the state in all its forms. Political language faithfully reflects the hierarchies by referring to party and state leaders in all official announcements. The front stage of Chinese politics, or Lenin's orchestra, are the government and other state organs, which ostensibly behave much like they do in many countries. The Ministry of Finance frames a budget each year amid age-old jockeying between rival claimants for limited funds. Ministers meet collectively as a cabinet to battle over their policy priorities. The many fine scholars in Chinese think tanks produce voluminous and often influential and incisive research reports. The courts deliver verdicts on the matters before them. The universities teach and dispense degrees. Journalists write stories. And the priests in the state-approved churches solemnly say Mass and administer the sacraments. But it is backstage, in the party forums, where the real stuff of politics is transacted. Under the Politburo sits a vast and largely secret party system which controls the entire public sector, including the military and the lives of the officials who work in all of China's 5 levels of government, starting in Beijing. The party staffs government ministries and agencies through an elaborate and opaque appointment system, instructs them on policy through behind-the-scenes committees, and guides their political posture and public statements through the propaganda network. The officials working in public institutions are trained and retrained at regular intervals through the party's extensive nationwide network of 2,800 schools before they are eligible for promotion. Should they be accused of bribery, fraud, or any other criminal conduct, they are investigated by the party first and only turned over to the civilian justice system on its say-so. Even then, any punishment meted out by the courts is at the behest and direction of party organs, which ultimately control the judges directly and the lawyers indirectly through legal associations and licensing. China retains many of the formal institutional trappings that give it a superficial resemblance to a pluralist system, with executive government, a parliament, and courts. But the party's pervasive backstage presence means the front stage role of these bodies must be constantly recalibrated against the reality of the power that lies largely out of sight behind them. The tentacles of the state, and thus the party, go well beyond the government. As well as sitting above state-owned businesses and regulatory agencies, these party departments oversee key think tanks, the courts, the media, all approved religions, and universities and other educational institutions, and maintain direct influence over NGOs and some private companies. The party also directly controls China's 8 so-called democratic parties by appointing their leaders and financing their budgets. The front stage and backstage roles are blurred in government, as most of the senior behind-the-scenes directors, producers, and scriptwriters in the party also star in public government roles. Hu Jintao is party secretary, but he also carries the more junior title of state president. Likewise, the Politburo, headed by Hu, sits above the state council, China's equivalent of a cabinet, which is headed by the premier, Wen Jiabao, who is also on the Politburo. When Hu visits Washington and other Western capitals, he is always billed as president and head of state at the insistence of the Chinese and not as the general secretary of the Chinese Communist Party, which is his most important position. Hu only flaunts his party title on trips overseas to the handful of surviving fraternal communist states like Cuba, Vietnam, and North Korea. To do it in places like the White House lawn would be unnecessarily embarrassing to his host. It would also lift the public profile of the party, which Hu and other leaders have no interest in doing. The division of roles between the party and government is more than just perplexing for outsiders. It is a huge source of hidden tension within the system itself, as illustrated by the political blow-up over the spread of the deadly SARS virus in 2003. The crisis over SARS, which threatened to bring the country and the economy to a standstill, was brought under control when Hu Jintao stepped in to sack the health minister and the Beijing mayor for covering up the true extent of the virus's spread. The leadership had been shamed into action by a retired army surgeon in Beijing. The surgeon faxed details of the correct number of people afflicted with the virus to foreign journalists to circumvent the propaganda department diktats, which had deliberately minimized the figures of those affected. Hu's dramatic intervention was hailed by local and foreign commentators as a watershed, a moment when a hitherto closed and unresponsive system was forced to be open and accountable. That was not how the sackings were viewed from the inside. The minister and the mayor, both occupying government posts, were not responsible for the cover-up, critics argued. In the case of the mayor, he was answerable to the Beijing Party Committee. The health minister was subservient to internal party bodies governing health policy. Neither operated with autonomy. Many government officials were extremely upset about this because they said they had simply been carrying out decisions made by party committees and party bosses higher up than them, an advisor to Hu told me. These two were scapegoats. Aside from a few largely symbolic exceptions, every senior government minister or official is a party member. By contrast, every senior party official does not always hold down a government post. Many instead work for the key party departments, which outrank mere government ministries. The Central Organization Department is responsible for personnel appointments. The Central Propaganda Department handles news and information. The United Front Department, as its name suggests, has a brief to lock in support for the party in power centers outside of its direct purview, like overseas Chinese business communities in Hong Kong and Taiwan, and in social organizations at home. Throughout the system, the party has positioned itself like a political panopticon, allowing it to keep an eye on any state or non-state agency while shielding itself from view at the same time. The panopticon was the innovative penitentiary designed by Jeremy Bentham, the 18th century English philosopher, which allowed a handful of wardens to watch inmates without being observed themselves. China is not one giant prison, as Chiang Kai-shek, the former foreign minister, used to say in an acid rebuttal of Western criticism of the country's human rights records. By many measures, China is freer than it has ever been. But the party, in retreating from the private lives of Chinese, has made sure it secures the heights of the political battlefield along the way. Like the panopticon, the party is omnipresent in the country's politics, with the benefit of remaining largely unobserved itself. The party is like God, a professor from the People's University in Beijing told me. He is everywhere, you just can't see him. In the late 1990s in Beijing, I attended a small dinner with Rupert Murdoch, where he declared he had yet to meet any communists during his trips to China. On the face of it, it was an odd statement because any Chinese government official of any consequence is nominally communist, or at least a member of the party. If Murdoch wanted to do business in China, especially in the media, among the most sensitive sectors for private foreign capital, he could not avoid the party. In fact, he would have to embrace it, as he eventually tried to do. It took many years and much supplication for Murdoch to secure a meeting with the then propaganda chief, Ding Guanggen, a key figure ranked number 8 in the party hierarchy until 2002. Later, Murdoch joined forces in an expensive business venture with Ding's son in an effort to find a way around China's tight restrictions on foreign broadcasting, all to no avail. By 2009, Mr. Murdoch had all but given up on China altogether. Murdoch is not alone in remarking on the absence of communists in China. It is something I have heard over many years from streams of sophisticated, no-nonsense foreign businessmen and women passing through China, mostly after coming directly from a meeting with a senior party official. Their statements are understandable in one respect. The sole experience of Chinese communism for many business leaders who have invested in and profited from the transformation of the country into an economy that often appears on the surface to be a uniquely unbridled form of capitalism are officials who want to do business. One of Murdoch's most powerful editors, Kelvin McKenzie, was stunned by China's development under communism when he visited Beijing with a British delegation in 2000. As the one-time editor of The Sun, the best-selling tabloid which famously features a topless girl on page 3 of every edition, McKenzie had been a scourge of the left and a champion of Thatcherism. In China, he told his bemused hosts in a booming voice over lunch that, on returning home to Britain, he was going to become a communist too, to invigorate his homeland. For visitors like McKenzie, the only time they might stumble across the Little Red Book would be on an excursion to a weekend flea market en route to the airport to fly home. Western elites were once familiar with the order of battle in communist politics, mainly through study of the pioneering model in the former Soviet Union and the mini-industry in academia, think tanks and journalism known as Kremlinology. The collapse of the Soviet Empire in the early...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.